according to Isaiah chapter 11. In Isaiah 11 verse 1, the Bible says, there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse. Immediately we know this is talking about David and also about Jesus Christ, his son. Amen. And a branch shall grow out of his roots. Jesus is the offspring and the root of David. Is that not so? So we are talking about Jesus Christ here. Can we read verse 2? Verse 2 says, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. See, the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. All right. How many? The Spirit of wisdom and understanding. The Spirit of counsel and might. Stop. So there is a spirit of might. Is that not so? This is not just a gift of the Holy Ghost. You all know about the gifts of the Holy Ghost, right? What are some of the gifts? Word of wisdom, word of knowledge, discerning of spirits, right? The gifts of faith, gifts of healings, working of miracles, the gifts of utterance, prophecies, tongues, interpretations of tongues. You all know these ones, right? Those are gifts. Say those are gifts. Where do those gifts work? In the church. The Bible says God has given to each one severally. And the Holy Ghost moves in the church. And he determines who should move in what gift. Amen. So if the Holy Ghost is not ready to move in the gift of faith, you can try and try and try, nothing will happen. Are you all getting this? So the gift operates primarily inside the four walls, within the assembly, to edify the church, to help the people of God. Amen. But for you to step outside of this place, to touch the lives of someone there, you need anointing to rest upon you. When the anointing rests upon you, you are upgraded into what I call a ministry. Amen. And when the Spirit rests upon your life, God can work through you much more effectively. When the Spirit rests upon you, you don't just have a gift that you can use. Now the Holy Ghost is possessing you to do something. Amen. There's a difference between you operating by your giftings and the Holy Ghost operating through you forcefully. And that is where God is bringing us as a ministry. And that is where God is bringing you as an individual. Some say, no, Pastor, this is for pastors and prophets. No, it's for you. Amen. You meet more people than most pastors do. Amen. You have colleagues at work who are sick. You have colleagues at work who are going through various things. Amen. Some of the most powerful individuals in the Bible had nothing to do with the church. Look at Brother Joseph. The guy ministered powerfully in a prison, in Potiphar's house, and in Pharaoh's house. And this guy was able to dispense food to the whole world. The Bible says all nations came to Egypt. And Pharaoh sent them on to Joseph. So Joseph, by his gifts and by the ministry that God had upon his life, touched the world. Amen. Amen. An Old Testament saint was able to affect the whole known world. Look at Brother Daniel. The guy was a worker. Amen. And he was an excellent worker. The Bible says that the excellent spirit was upon his life. In Daniel 1 verse 17, God gave to this young man wisdom and understanding, literature and learning, into everything else. And the Bible says that God gave to Daniel understanding of all visions and dreams. So this man was a worker with anointing. He will go to work under the power of God. Hallelujah. Before he goes to work, he has prayed. Break time, he goes and prays again. When he's done working, he goes to pray again. The Bible records that he prayed 3 times a day. Morning, noon, and night, and evening. Amen. 3 times in a day. And he was a worker. And this guy working was able to affect the whole land of Babylon. Amen. In fact, he moved so powerfully. One day he interpreted the dream of Nebuchadnezzar, and the king bowed down to him. Now think about this. In those days, if the king sits down, then you can sit down. If the king gets up, you all get up. The king is always above everybody else, right? If he bows down, who is going to be sitting down? Everybody has to be bowing down. So when Daniel explained that dream and gave the interpretation and advised the book of Nebuchadnezzar, the Bible says he bowed down. I know that everybody else bowed down to him. So this man, as a worker, as a member of the cabinet, was able to affect the environment and affect the marketplace through the gifts and the ministry that was upon his life. Are you hear what I'm saying? We don't call a Daniel a Pastor Daniel. Amen. We in the church will call him Prophet Daniel. But in the book of Nebuchadnezzar's court, they didn't know anything like Prophet Daniel. They only knew him as a wise man. In fact, some knew him as a magician. Some called him, and in fact, the Bible called him, if you look at how the book of Nebuchadnezzar called him, the chief of the wise men, the chief of the wizards, the chief of the witches. Are you hearing this? But that anointing upon his life touched every single person. That is what I'm telling you. Wherever you are, God can use you. Amen. Wherever you are, the anointing upon your life can affect the environment. Are you all hearing this? When God has given you a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge, when the Spirit rests upon you, those gifts come into manifestation. And those gifts manifest more powerfully when the Holy Ghost is resting upon you than otherwise. Hallelujah. Amen. Now, you can't go to your workplace and begin to prophesy as you would prophesy in the church. Ah, the Holy Ghost is telling me this. Holy Ghost is moving on me. Amen. No. At the workplace, you have to be different. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Are you all hearing this word?
Yes.
Amen. When you're ministering as a minister of God or a witness of God in the marketplace, you have to be able to relate to the people there. You didn't see Joseph winding up his prophetic wheels before he ministered to Pharaoh. You know, I know some of us, when we're about to minister prophetically, we have to prime the prophetic, you know, pump a little bit. We have to shake it a little bit. Hallelujah. Our voice have to come with some, you know, some power. Hallelujah. We have to lift up our voice. That's it! No. Just to say, Pharaoh, those seven things you saw, and those seven cows, and it is wandering. And I'm telling you that there's going to be 7 years of prosperity. His voice was normal. Are you hearing this? He was under the power of God, and yet his voice was what? Normal. He's in the marketplace. And then he says, Pharaoh, after this, there will be 7 years of famine. I'm telling you that it will happen. There's no disputing this. So let me advise you. 7 years of prosperity, what do? You gather all the good stuff, right? And then give, you know, 80% out for them to eat, but take 20%. And in the days of famine, take out the stuff that you saved and give it out. The Bible says that Pharaoh said, who else can we give this job to? But to Mr. Joseph. Now, because of Joseph's anointing, he said that interpretations belong to who? To God. The magicians, the wizards, they could not tell what that dream was all about. Right? But by the anointing on his life, only he was capable. That means that when the anointing falls on you, the abilities of the world begins to shrink. So that the focus will fall upon you. And then God begins to distinguish you. And now people realize that there is a God in heaven. Hallelujah. And because of this grace, Joseph has so much power that he fed all his brothers and his father. He told his father, I will send you ahead of you to take care of you. So when you succeed in the marketplace, guess what? You come and think of people in the church. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Amen. You think that because Daniel was there, wasn't the other people fine? He told King Nebuchadnezzar, my friends also need jobs. Amen. When he was made a big guy, he made sure that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego also got some powerful positions. Amen. So when you succeed in the marketplace, it blesses the church. Amen. Are you getting this then? Nehemiah. Was he Pastor Nehemiah? He was a cupbearer. Yet this man became the governor over Israel. Because of how he excelled in the marketplace, he became the person who feed people in this place. He built the walls of Israel. Hallelujah. So when you succeed in the marketplace, it goes both ways. Are you getting this? God wants you to succeed in the marketplace. Amen. God didn't design us only to operate within the four walls of the church. The enemy is very happy when you prophesy in a church to church people. So far as you don't step outside and minister to his people and prophesy them out of their dungeons. He wants you to see all the demons in people inside the church but not outside the church.
That's right.
Hallelujah. You should be able to go to a place and say, hey, you know, you have three demons in you. So what is a demon? There are three things I'm seeing in you. You yesterday, you had an argument with your wife over the food that she cooked for you. She burnt it and the smell filled the whole house. And you became angry with her. And I see the two of you. So what in the world? Are you a psychic? No, I'm not a psychic. I'm a Christian.
Hallelujah.
Do you know that your wife is actually planning to divorce you? My wife! She will never do that, what I'm telling you. The next day, the guy comes crying. What he said came to pass. My wife is trying to divorce me. What should I do? Now you have a way to help this guy. Yes. Now you're not ministering only to Brother Joe or Brother this. You are ministering to that heathen out there. Jesus Christ, the gift in his life, ministered to that woman at the well. That woman wasn't Brother this. That sister wasn't an usher. No, this sister was out there. Hallelujah. And Jesus ministered to her as somebody was out there. Ministered very nicely. Jesus said, that saith the Lord, I'm speaking to you by the power of God. You are an adulteress. You are going to hell. Says, give water to drink. So to minister to people in the marketplace, you must know their language. You must relate to them. Are you getting this way? Give me water to drink. That's how he started his prophetic ministry to that woman. Madam, go and bring your husband. Oh, I don't have a husband. You see how Jesus gently went his way? Then he said, you are a truthful person. You are not a liar. You see how Jesus did it? Then says, you have five men. And the one you are with is not your husband. So what you are saying is true. You don't have any man. Isn't this wonderful? And the woman began to break down. Not knowing that this woman was a theologist. She was somebody who was interested in theological discourses. He said, no, God said that we should worship him. Are you guys worship there in Jerusalem? She just said that, you know what, madam, you are wrong. And I've never really told that you are wrong because you just saw me ministering prophetically to you. So I have authority to declare who is right from wrong, right? He says that what you guys are doing is wrong. The Jews, the salvation is of the Jews. But right now the time has come where God will be looking for those who worship him in spirit and in truth. It wouldn't matter where you worship him from. It has to be in your heart. Blessed be the name of the Lord. That woman went and brought the whole city of Samaria to Jesus Christ. And after Jesus ministered to them, they said, woman, we are not believing only because of your testimony, but because of what we have actually heard this man. God wants to move us out into the marketplace. That's where God wants us. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
We come here to refuel, to charge our batteries, and then we step out there and take over the world. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The whole world is your parish. When you step into your workplace, that place is your parish. That is your church. You are the pastor of that workplace. You are the prophet over there. What you say goes. Blessed be the name of the Lord. God wants to raise you to do that.
Amen.
Say, Father, make me
your
servant in my workplace, in my school, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You are all given, you all have gifts. I'm telling you the truth. Every Christian, every child of God has gifts. In fact, you'll be lying to yourself if you didn't say yes. You have gifts inside of you. But you are waiting for that day where you will get the mic. Where Pastor Paul will travel. And Reverend Judy will also be out of town. And then you will be the next person to hold the mic. Not knowing that you can hold the mic on Monday, on Tuesday, on Wednesday, on Thursday, on Friday, on Saturday. Blessed be the name of the Lord. God can use you anytime, anywhere. Blessed be the name of the Lord. God wants to do this. If God is going to take over this world, we need to have a seven-day ministry. We can't just come on Fridays and fire ourselves up and then go burn ourselves out the rest of the days. Are you hearing this word? And that is where the Spirit of God comes in. Because the Spirit of God will talk to you. You can even go to the restaurant and the waitress, God will show you things about her. Amen. That when you begin to reveal it to her, she will open up. And then you can minister to her. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Isn't this wonderful? I want to be able to minister in the marketplace. You should be the marriage counselor at your workplace. Any marriage in trouble, the people should come to you. And say, ah, are you to the person who was advising this brother? He told me about that advice you gave me and went out. Can you help me also? Any person in trouble at the workplace must come to you. Are you hearing this prayer? I mean, when people are sick, the first person is, oh, you go to that woman, she'll do something for you, you'll be all right. Hallelujah. Any person with a cough should come to you straight away. Hallelujah. Your office, your cubicle must become a hospital. It must become how do you call those people who advise people whose minds are not working very well? You should be the psychologist. Hallelujah. You should be the psychologist at your workplace. Any person with a mental problem should come to you for help. Are you hearing this? Say, Father, use me in this manner. And one of the spirits that God will give you to do this is might. The spirit of counsel and might. That means that the two of them go together. We have been talking about the spirit of counsel. The spirit of counsel is how God advises you to do what you have to do. This spirit was very heavy upon Joseph and Daniel and many of the prophets. But God is not just interested in you advising people and not being able to actually help them to perform what you advise them to do. Amen. Joseph was advising the king and also showing him how to preserve the state of Egypt. Amen. God wants you not just to have a talk, but also the power.
Amen.
Amen. God is not just interested in you being able to talk, but also in you being able to demonstrate the power of God. The church today has become a lot of talk. Amen. We do a lot of talking, very little demonstration. Amen. I remember back in the days when I was in high school, you know, in Africa, in those days, we didn't have as many resources as those over here. Amen. So when we went for a music class, it was a blackboard and chalk. Amen. The organ was a very holy place where the music teacher would sit there and would not allow you to touch it. Everybody had to stand within 2 feet of the organ and not touch it. So everything was literal, theory. Amen. So we had an acronym for music. Most useless subject in class. That's what we said. Why? Because we didn't get in out of those classes. They would say, okay, this is the bass clef, and they'll do that thing. This is the treble clef. And then they'll do the bass, the five things, pow, pow, pow. And then we have to learn all this stuff. That was nonsense. We didn't have any practical knowledge. You understand this? In the same way, the church has become theory, but no practical. God is about to change that. God is going to give us the power to back our words. The world we live in, they need to see something. They are not convinced anymore. Amen. Every TV station, we have a lot of speech, a lot of talk, very little demonstration. And the very few people who are demonstrating the power of God under persecution, even by the church. Isn't that sad? God is not just a God who... See, God speaks by demonstration. See, God speaks by demonstration. When God speaks, it's a mighty use. I mean, when He speaks, it is His power in manifestation. See, when God speaks, it is miracles. It is signs. It is wonders. Hallelujah. Can we go to the book of Exodus very quickly? Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. How would you like somebody to come to your house and say, I'm a plumber? And they begin to describe your problem to you. And begin to show you what needs to be done to solve your problem. You tell me, okay, go ahead and solve the problem. No, I know the problem. Okay, thank you very much for describing the problem to me. Solve my problem. The water is filling up this house. Please do something. Oh, I can't really do that. I can show you everything about the problem you have. It is because that screw is out of place. Well, solve the problem. Amen. We can't be politicians. Not how politicians are. Politicians are very powerful. They can answer your questions but give no solutions. God is not a politician. Hallelujah. If he says something, he's doing it. He doesn't joke. Say, God doesn't joke. Hallelujah. Now let's go to Exodus chapter 4. Hallelujah. Are we all there? Verse 6. Exodus 4 verse 6. Say, Spirit of might. Hallelujah. The Lord said further unto him, that's to Moses, put now thy hand into thy bosom. He put his hand into his bosom. When he took it out, behold, his hand was leprous as snow. He said, put thy hand into that bosom again. He put his hand into his bosom again. He plucked it out of his bosom. Behold, it was turned again as his other flesh. That means it became normal, right? And it came to pass, come on, read verse 8. Verse 8 is very important. Verse 8. Are we there? And it shall come to pass, if they will not believe thee, neither hearken to the voice of the first sign, that they will believe the voice of the latter sign. So a miracle is the speech of God. When God speaks, it is miracles, signs, and wonders. Amen. So when God speaks, that's why the Bible says that they went everywhere and preached the gospel, the Lord working with them, confirming the word with what? Signs. So when God speaks, it has to be confirmed. Because how else will people know that this is not just another God speaking? How would they know that it is God speaking? When there is something to authenticate and accreditate what he's saying. May God give us those signs and wonders. In fact, the disciples were being told to shut up and not to talk. They went to their prayer team and what did they say? Father, give us the boldness to speak your word. How? By stretching forth your hand as you did in the days of Moses. Stretch out your hand to heal and to perform. He says perform miracles, signs, and wonders. That's how the church grew. That's how the church was able to expand. God is bringing those days back to us. Amen. We shall walk in miracles. We shall walk in signs. And we shall walk in wonders. Amen. Let's go to Hebrews chapter 2. Are you learning something tonight? Yes. It's a spirit of counsel and spirit of might. Oh, hallelujah. See, now all night you have all the time in the world to take your time to chill out. Amen. Hallelujah. Do you know that all night is what heaven likes? I don't get much response on that. It's good. All right. Hebrews 2 and verse 3. How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, right? Which at first began to be spoken, say spoken, by the Lord, that's Jesus Christ, and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him, that is the apostles. Amen. But how does God speak? Verse 4. God also bearing them witness. Both with what? That's how God speaks. When God speaks, is a sign, is a miracle. Diverse miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost according to his will. See, when God speaks, it is signs, it is wonders, diverse miracles, and gifts of the Holy Ghost. Are you all seeing this? So if today the church is not demonstrating the miracle signs and wonders, then guess what? God is not speaking. If this is not happening, then we got a problem. And let's not lie to ourselves. Amen. Let's not make ourselves happy and say that, oh, the gifts have ceased. They have not ceased. God does not change his ways. He says, I'm God, I change not. If this is how he speaks, that's how he still speaks. He hasn't changed his ways. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. Hallelujah. We have seen miracles upon miracles in this house. I have lost count of the miracles. And that there are miracles being done by members of this church. Are you all getting this? The miracles are begetting miracles. Amen. And this year there will be an explosion of even more miracles. Hallelujah. We are going to see legs growing out. We're going to see limbs growing out and being restored whole as the other. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We're going to see the blind seeing in this house. The deaf, we have already seen the deaf hearing. Amen. We've seen the blind seeing. Hallelujah. Many of these miracles have already taken place. We see people being brought here in wheelchairs. And they climbing out of those chairs. Can I hear a big amen? Amen. Amen. We have seen new body parts documented by the medical schools. By the medical community. What is left to be done? To empty hospitals. God is going to teach us how to do these things. God had to step down and teach Moses how to do miracles, signs, and wonders. Amen. Was the last 2 weeks, God was teaching me some miracles. God can teach you how to do miracles. He was showing me how to do it. May God show us how to do miracles. As we are giving this word, God will be visiting you. There is something that God has brought you into this world that only you can do. John said, a man can do nothing except what God gives him. Are you getting it? And some of these things, God has to come down and teach you. In fact, Elijah said, all these things I did it at your command. So when he drenched that water, it was God that told him to drench that water. Everything you do must be because of what you have seen God doing. Oh, hallelujah. That is God speaking. See how God speaks? Number one, what? Signs. Number two, oneness. Number three, diverse, different kinds of. So when Jesus came, guess what? Miracles. He said, I came not to do my will, but the will of him that sent me. So the power of God, the spirit of mine was upon him. So in Luke 4, he said, the spirit of God is upon me. Because the Lord has anointed me. See, the Lord has anointed me. Oh, Jesus is Lord. Some of you, God will teach you how to heal people with mental diseases. Some of you, God will come and show you how to cast out devils. Some of you, God will, and if God did it before, he's going to do it to you. Amen. Hallelujah. Let's go to John chapter 5. Spirit of counsel and might. Counsel releases power. Say, counsel releases power. God has many ways of doing the same thing. And at times, it may not be his will for you to lay hands. Another time, it may be his will for you to just tell the person to just walk. Instead of helping him to walk. At times, you tell somebody to jump. Amen. I remember when our sister, your arm was, wasn't. I saw in my mind's eye helping something like this. So I told her, do your hand like that. And when she did it, boom, and then left her. You understand that? That was what counsel released the power of God. So God can tell Elisha, tell that leprous guy to go to the River Jordan and dip in the water 7 times. Not 6 times, but what? 7 times. When he did it, what happened? He was fine. Never said, no, that's not the normal way to heal the sick. You should come and lay hands, say a few things, pray over me with some apostolic favor, and then I'll be healed. Elisha said, go and bath. He said, what do you mean? We have bathrooms, I have jacuzzis, I have everything I need. I don't need this thing. The servant straightened him out. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So when God gives you counsel, it releases the power of God. Amen. Hallelujah. John chapter 5, verse 19. Say, power of God fall upon my life in Jesus' name. Can we read this? Then answered Jesus and said unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself but what he seeth the Father do. For what things soever he doeth, these also doeth the Son likewise. Verse 20. For the Father loveth the Son and showeth him. Hallelujah. All things that himself doeth, and he will show him greater things that ye may what? Marvel. Blessed be the name of the Lord. So Jesus said, guys, everything you see me do, it comes out of something I've seen the Father do it. So that is why he will spend so much time in prayer every morning. The Bible says a great while before our Lord Jesus will go to a solitary place. He will separate himself from people and then he will pray. You don't have a private prayer life. It's in your private prayer times that God will show you these things. God will speak to you about how to do things. About our last healing crusade over here in this church, I was like, God, how do you want to do things today? He said, I want you to move in the kingly anointing. You know there are four different kinds of anointing. You have the leper anointing, the priestly anointing, the kingly anointing, and the imperial anointing. And at any point in time, God will have you flow in one of these. Amen. One time you have you flow in the imperial anointing, which is just speak, and then things begin to happen. Or the kingly anointing, where you order and command things to straighten up, and things happen. Or the priestly anointing, where you do mostly, you minister to the person by praying for the person. Amen. And the leper anointing is almost like the priestly anointing. Amen. You minister as a newborn Christian. Amen. You know those who are born again, fresh, there's some anointing upon their life. They are eager to preach the gospel. There's a fervor. Blessed be the name of the Lord. There are different anointings out there. And you need to have God tell you how you should flow. Blessed be his name. If you don't tap into what God is doing, you can't see a lot of results. You, at best, your gifts, the gift that God has given you will manifest. But how many of you know that gifts are usually limited in scope? Amen. Your gift may do one thing but not be able to do another thing. But when God is moving, you can do anything. Isn't that so? That is why we try to. You see that during our healing service, we do a lot of singing. Right? What are we trying to do? We are trying to tap into the vein of what God is trying to do for that particular service. God, what do you want to do today? Amen. We can dispense with all that and just operate out of our gifts. And people will be healed, but not too many people. But when you can hear what God is saying, I want you to do this way, then more things can happen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Say, counsel releases power. Hallelujah. So Jesus said, whatever I do comes and flows out of what I have seen the Father do. For us to flow in the power and in the might of God, we have to be revelatory. We have to have the seeing eye. We need the hearing ears. Amen. Brother and sister, let me tell you something. Everything you have naturally, you have it spiritually. See, everything I have naturally, I have it spiritually. That's why Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15, first the flesh, then the spirit. God expects you to be spiritually alive. Spiritually, you have ears. Are you aware? That's how you hear the voice of God. You have eyes to have visions of God. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. You are a new man in Christ Jesus. But you're looking the same. But you have a new man on the inside. Born from above. Made in the very image of God. The very DNA of God in you. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Say, my ears have spiritual ears. For my eyes, I have spiritual eyes. Hallelujah. Father, I release a seeing eye. And I release a hearing ear in this house. That your people can hear your voice loud and clear. That they will see you clearly. So that they can be able to hear and tap into what you are doing. So that they can be a blessing to this world. In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. One day Jesus Christ during his prayer time, God said, go down there to the pool of Bethesda. There will be many sick people there when you get there. I want you to heal just one person. I'm sure Jesus said, but what about the other people there? He said, no, I'm not interested in you healing anybody but that one person. He's been sick for how many years? 38 years. He's paralyzed. So when Jesus went there, Bob said, he looked for him. Amen. And he saw him. So he must have walked over some blind people, right? Some lame people, right? And you know, for just one person, and he healed him. He said, young man, what's your problem? Do you want to be well? Hallelujah. Jesus started talking about his problem. Isn't it interesting? The most difficult people to pray for are those who are so much engrossed in their sicknesses. Amen. When you ask some people, do you want to be well? Then they begin to tell you the history of their sickness. Now, I could have asked you, what is the history of your sickness? Hallelujah. The question is, do you want to be well? The question wasn't how you are suffering and how nobody is trying to help you and how you're trying to get into the river and nobody pushes you to the river. And every time you're about to get in, somebody else gets in before you. Jesus said to the answer. He said, do you want to be well? The guy started talking a lot, just said, just chill out. Rise up, walk. He had seen the Father doing this already. So you see the confidence that was manifested when he healed this guy. I mean, when they told him, Lazarus is sick. The man said, Jesus loved this guy so much. He didn't do anything. Now, if you love somebody, you will stop your crusade and run and go and help him. He said, because he loved him, he waited some more days. Then after some days, he said, guys, I think we need to go to our dear friend. Because Lazarus is sleeping and we need to go and wake him up. Question is, why did he have to wait that long? The Father told him, don't go yet. Wait. I want to manifest my glory. That's why Jesus said that this sickness is not unto death, but for the manifestation of the glory of God. So Jesus knew that this guy would die. How did he know that? God had told him. Amen. So when he stood before Lazarus, he says, Lord, I know you hear me always. And in fact, this prayer is just for the benefit of the people who are watching. Amen. Lazarus, come forth. The guy came out. He saw the Father doing it. He said, this is for the glory of God. That means God himself was going to do this thing. May we learn how to see what God is doing. Amen. So that we can release what he has done in the natural realm. Amen. But as a sister, we must receive miracles in the spiritual realm before we can see them manifest fully in the natural realm. You must see things before you can do things to be most effective. Amen.
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 Hallelujah. I don't know, one day God may release me to talk about the four dimensions of power. There are four flows of the power of God. Amen. One flow of the power of God is called ikus. Say ikus. You know, here we learn a little bit of Greek every time. You know, that's Pastor Paul. That's my way. A little bit of Greek. Hallelujah. You know your New Testament came from Greek? You are aware, right? It was written in Greek. Well, the Bible says in, James, that the prayer, the fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much. Is that not so? The word availeth, the Amplified will tell you, makes much power available. Amen. This is energy and spiritual power that is generated when you pray. Haven't you felt so powerful after you pray for a long time? You have released power. And that power that you release is called Dukus power. It is the power that charges the dunamis within you. Amen. Say dunamis. Dunamis is the miracle power of God. Amen. That is the power that Jesus walked in. But there is something that charges that power. What charges that power is your prayer. When you pray, you charge that battery. And when you step out of your secret room, you're online. And things begin to happen. So as you make your prayers, the effective prayer, the fervent prayer of a righteous man, makes power. It charges you. That is why the Bible says, building yourself up on your most holy faith. Day one, praying. So as you pray, you are releasing what we call ikus, power. Say, Ikus power.
Ikus power.
Yes, you are in all nations today. When you count all nations, you speak Greek. So the English power is when you pray and you pray and there's a force. There's an energy in you. You say, you pick up that phone. My sister, you're having a sickness. I want to pray for you right now. The first time, you didn't want to pray for the sister. You didn't feel any connection to heaven. But after your prayer, you feel energized. You feel charged. You pray, that person gets healed. What released that? The prayer anointing has released that power. Hallelujah. That power is here. See, it's here. Ephesians says the power that worketh within, right? There's a power that is inside of you. That is dunamis. Say dunamis. Hallelujah. You get dunamis when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. So as you pray, the Holy Ghost comes upon you. And that dunamis is charged. And then when you lay hands, boom, the person gets healed. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Are you getting this? The God release the ukus to charge up and to release what? The dunamis. Say dunamis. Dunamis is dynamite. It's the mighty power of God in manifestation. Amen. The Bible says that the angel Gabriel told Mary. Mary was like, how shall this be since I know no man? It says, the power of the highest shall overshadow you. That word power is dunamis. And that power is who? The Holy Ghost. So when the Holy Ghost comes upon you, dunamis is released. Amen. It says that that which will be of you will be what? Holy. The anointing, when it releases, it is holy. You know, there are lying wonders. The devil also can duplicate miracle signs and wonders. But we call that lying wonders. And the devil can never give you something without taking something from you.
That's right.
Amen. But when God comes upon you to do something, it is a holy thing. Amen. So when Mary gave birth, it was holy. He said, the Holy Ghost will come upon you, and that which will conceive in you will be a holy thing. Amen. So you need the power of the Holy Ghost upon you. Acts 1 verse 8 says, but ye shall receive dunamis. You shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost is come upon. Say, Holy Ghost, come upon me in power. Brother, sister, when Holy Ghost comes upon you in power, you feel it. You know it.
Amen.
Amen. And that is when powerful things can happen. Brother, sister, this is what the world needs. The world doesn't need our nice sermons. The world needs a demonstration of the power. The world needs an exhibition.
Oh, yes, yes, yes.
They needed to exhibit something that will testify to them that indeed God is good. There's a guy that we prayed for who I know is a Muslim, amen. And he saw the power of God. Now, how else can you witness to someone like that? After they see the power of God, what else is left to be done? Blessed be the name of the Lord. That is the most effective witness. Amen. For them to see the God's power in manifestation. Jesus said that if I just spoke the word without doing the works, the people will have an excuse. But now they've heard my word and have seen my works, they don't have any excuse. In fact, Jesus said that if Sodom and Gomorrah had seen the miracles that I did, they would have remained to this day.
Yes, yes.
So that means there's a testimony that is of a lower grade. That means what Abraham did was a lower grade than what Jesus did. All Abraham could do was spoke in a priestly anointing to pray and intercede. But it didn't go long far enough. But Jesus in a kingly and imperial anointing can go further than what those guys can do. That is what we are talking about. We are in an energizing mode right now. God is empowering us through this word to step out of these walls and to raise the dead, cast out devils, heal the sick, and cleanse the lepers. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
To be able to walk into the hospital and say the kingdom of God has come unto you, Duke University Hospital. And to see the people being healed, blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Every time we've been to the hospital, to this date, every person we have prayed for in the hospital came out. Amen. But I'm like, God, that is not enough. Hallelujah. I want to see entire wards healed. Hallelujah. I'm like, Lord, what about the other people? What about this ward? At times when I'm going up the elevator, I'm like, God, as I'm going up, let everybody be healed. Amen. I'm laying the groundwork for God can do. The Bible says, open your mouth wide. Maybe we are not opening our mouth wide enough. Every time you enter the hospital, say, Father, every sick person in this hospital is healed today. Nobody will die today. Every cancer is healed today. Father, whoever is in this hospital with a heart problem, I decree that that person is healed. One day God will open your eyes. You see, God is going to do mighty and wonderful things. You need to set expectations. Say expectation.
Expectation.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then, of course, you have Igus, you have Dunamis, you have something called Isousia. Say Isousia. Again, I told you, you are in all nations. All nations, you will learn Greek. Amen. The first one is Igus, I-S-C-H-U-S. The second one is Dunamis, that is Holy Ghost power, D-U-N-A-L-I-S. This one is powerful. Esousia is E-X-O-U-S-I-A. Esousia. It means authority. It means liberty. Freedom to do something. This was what Peter walked away. He said, and silver and gold have I not. But such as I have, give I thee. By the power of the Holy Ghost. No. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up. That is authority. Authority is knowing who you are and operating out of your identity. Hallelujah. One man that operated in this very powerful Smith Wigglesworth. That is one of the anointings I walk in more than anything else. Amen. Authority is just knowing that Jesus is in you. Hallelujah. And authority is taking the word of God and say, the Bible says I will lay hands on the sick and they will recover. The word authorizes you to believe God for that very thing you read about. Authority number one is know who you are. Amen. That's what the devil was attacking Jesus over. If you are the Son of God, turn this thing into bread. If you are the Son of God, jump. Angels will hold you up. Anything to, but God the Father told him, this is my beloved Son. The Father has spoken. Satan comes, if. So already he's throwing doubt into your mind. Hallelujah. I have seen some of the greatest miracles when there wasn't much movement, when there wasn't much power, nothing much happening. I've seen more people healed in homes rather than here in the church. And it comes out of what? Identity. Knowing who you are. Do you know that Jesus is in you? Do you know you are the embassy of heaven? Do you know the Holy Ghost is dwelling inside you? Know you not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost? The Bible says, if God be with you, who can be against you? Hallelujah. The one in us is greater than he that is in the world. Look at Romans 8 verse 11. Romans 8 verse 11 is for those who like Esousia. Amen. You must walk on the authority of the word of God when everything else fails. Amen. Are you here? But if the spirit of him that raised Christ or Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he that raised up Jesus from the dead shall also quicken your mortal. What is mortal? Something that is corruptible, right? Your mortal body is by his spirit that dwelleth in you. So you walk around aware and conscious of the fact that the spirit of the highest dwells inside you. You are aware that the spirit that raised up our Lord Jesus from the dead dwells in you. And that same spirit that raised up Christ from the dead, being in you, can raise up other people from the dead.
Amen.
You must understand what you have. And when you understand what you have and what you are, that things you do automatically. And it comes out of your identity. Amen. Jesus gave them authority over all devils to cast them out and to heal all manner of sickness. And the Bible says in Mark 6 that they went everywhere with oil and anointed people with oil and they were healed. The authority given to them, they executed on it and they saw results. As you leave this place and as you execute this word, you will have results. You will have results. One energizing word, one word that gives you authority is in John 14 verse 12. Amen. Whatever you read in the word has already been tried 7 times.
Hallelujah.
Jesus said that heaven and earth will pass away, but my words never pass away. His words have been tried. It can't fail. I said that John 14 verse 12. Are we there? Hallelujah. John 14 verse 12 is one of my, I don't know whether I'll say the most favorite, but it is probably the most favorite verse. Amen. This word gives you authority. Say authority. Exousia. Hallelujah.
Amen.
My sister is saying it with what is the word to use? He's saying it with them. He's saying it. He aspires it. Hallelujah. Verily, verily, I say unto you. You see the certification, double certification. That he that has dunamis. No. He that has it and the ukus.
No.
No. He that
believes
on me. The works that I do, shall he do also. Greater works shall he do. Because I go to the Father. Hallelujah. He says that some things you do just by believing in me. Not because you feel the Holy Ghost upon you. Not because you have prayed 10,000 hours. But just by believing that what Jesus did is a template for me. That I can just reenact and replicate what Jesus did and I will see it manifest in my own life.
Amen.
That's all you have to do.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You see a blind person, you just say, ah, Jesus took some spit, put on some stuff, mixed it up, put on the eyes, told the guy, go to the pool of Siloam and wash, right? You can say, oh, that is too long. There's another one, he just said, Ephata. So you just touch the person with Ephata. Be open. Dude cannot begin to see. Brother and sister, how can you know that this works unless you try?
That's right. That's true.
You know, one person that one that I said to was the only answer, if you ask for something, the only thing that can mess you up, they can say no. But at least you try. You understand me? You can never know what you have and what you are unless you execute. Many people, because of fear, amen, because of what fear, have not done anything. I like Peter. He said, if you would tell me to come, I'll come.
Yes.
Amen. And this guy did something that nobody else was willing to do. Jesus said, come. Hallelujah. Now that is where we see whether you're a man or a boy. Hallelujah. When Jesus says the words that you, the same shall you do, he's saying what? Come.
Hallelujah.
Now it's up to you to either respond or not to respond. And we choose to do what? To respond. And when we pray for people to be healed, we want to see results.
Amen.
But that you must know who you are.
Amen.
Say, I am seated.
I'm
on the right hand of God. Hallelujah. I am raised up together with the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm seated together with my Lord Jesus at the right hand of my Father. Hallelujah. When you know these things, it authorizes you to do what Jesus did. Are you understanding this? The word is what you need. Once you find, if you look at verse 13, whatsoever you shall ask in my name, that you shall do. No, he's going to do it. He never said he's going to do it. He said, whatever you ask, I will do it. I'm taking the responsibility. You are under no stress. I'm doing everything by myself. I will do it. That my Father may be what? Glorified. So if you're going to just see a black person that day, Jesus told me that whatever I ask, he will do it. So can we try this out? You mind if I pray for you? Put your hands on his eyes. In the name of Jesus, be opened. You will have a testimony.
Yes.
For Jesus will come.
Amen.
He's inside you.
Amen.
I in them, them in me, we in you. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Do you know what power you have? When you go to Ephesians 1, you will see all that you have. My brother and sister, there is another power called Kratos. Say Kratos.
Kratos.
This one is the best. This one is the very, very best. This is the kingdom of God manifesting in dominion. This is what kingdom manifesting in dominion. And this is not just your individual power. Do you know that there's a power that is released when the whole church comes together? We call that corporate anointing. But this goes beyond that. We call this kingdom power. And when the kingdom power is a manifestation, all that the Lord people did, all that the prophets did, is compounded in Jesus Christ. It's a double anointing. It goes far beyond the norm. It is a kind of power that can affect an entire region, an entire state. It can change the climate of an entire region.
Amen.
This kind of power can infiltrate the second heavens and tear down principalities, take over the airways of an entire city, and cause the word of God to permeate every house. This is the kind of things that bring about a city-wide revival.
Hallelujah.
Where a whole state comes under a standstill, nothing can happen because the kingdom of God has come in power.
Amen.
Amen. And usually it begins with your ikus, just praying, until your dunamis comes online. And when you couple the dunamis with your esousia, and then you move into kratos, my brother, my sister, it's powerful. You can't joke with this thing at all.
Amen.
May God take us through all this.
Amen.
Amen. That's what happened when Paul went to Ephesus. He started with just praying. He saw some disciples, right? Pray for them. Then they got the power of God came into them. Then they began to preach, witnessing for 2 years. Just preaching the word of God. Talk. Then boom! The power of God began to operate. The power of God rested on Paul. The Bible says God did special miracles through the hands of Paul, so that handkerchiefs, aprons left his body and were healing people after 2 years. And this continued until the trade of the demonic realm was being affected. They had witches and wizards, and they didn't have any person consulting them anymore. The psychics were being run out of town because there was nobody coming to their seances. Why would you come for a seance to see somebody speak by a purported spirit when a handkerchief is healing your daughter?
Hallelujah.
When an apron is raising the dead? What is this about? I'm going to sit down for someone to say, your uncle is telling me that your hair is gray. How is that going to help me? When a handkerchief is casting a devil out of my son. Are you hearing this? So one of the men rose up, Alexander the silversmith, and said, hey, this man is messing us up. Now we can't get people buying our stuff. Our goddess Diana is being unemployed by this guy Paul. I mean, it was so powerful that devils knew about Paul. He said, Jesus I know, Paul I know. But who are you? Are you hearing this? When this happened, the wizards and witches said, you know what? This is power past power. They came with their books. They came with their talismans and said, Paul, get it. Your handkerchiefs have liquidated our power. The handkerchiefs. And the Bible said, this continued until the word of God grew mightily and filled Asia. Let's look at Paul was preaching. And this continued by the space of how many years? 2 years. So that all that which dwelt in Asia heard the word of the Lord Jesus with Jesus and grace. You see how this begins? The word goes first. Say the word goes first.
The word goes first.
We are filling all of North Carolina with the word of God.
Amen.
By the grace of God, we are on public TV now.
Amen.
By the grace of God, we are on YouTube. Amen. God, by his sovereign power, is going to enlarge our host.
Amen.
Amen. We are going to have other TV stations.
Amen.
God is going to make that possible.
Amen.
And we are going to just release the word.
Amen.
Day in, day out. Just releasing the word. Just bombarding the airwaves. Taking over the airwaves. Dislodging the principalities and power. For 2 years, all of North Carolina shall hear the word of the living God.
Amen.
The word has to go first. The word was first preached by the Lord, according to Hebrews 2. Amen. And then, verse 11, God moved them to the next level. After 2 years, the handkerchief that a year before couldn't do anything was suddenly energized and became a storage battery of dunamis power that could drive out devils without Paul being there. Can you imagine that? Come with me, verse 11. And Paul ran special. Say special. See, that means there are miracles and there are special miracles. Special miracles is God doing something. Amen. And by the hands of Paul, so that from his body were brought unto the sick handkerchiefs or aprons, and the diseases departed from them, and the evil spirits went out of them. Did you guys hear that? This is power. A handkerchief casting out the devil. Mostly you go and lay hands on the person. In the name of Jesus, come out! You scream and scream and scream until you lose your voice. But this handkerchief was put on the guy. Boom, the devil slept the guy. The guy is healed. May that be our portion.
Amen.
You have to be faithful in the word to see the power of God released. If you are faithful in a little, God will give you much. There are too many men and women of God and children of God and believers and kingdom citizens all over the world waiting for an angel to come and say, hey, Kofi, today I'm giving you power. You'll be like Prophet Jeremiah. Go and preach my word. No. You have to be faithful in a little. Your little may be the 5 people you work with. Amen. You are faithful in giving them the word. And as you give the word, one day you'll be energized. You'll be animated. You'll be empowered. And you begin to do what the word said. Now Jesus will begin to confirm the word you're speaking with signs and wonders for you. But you got to be faithful in a little. As you're faithful and now God will listen to the special time. Amen. And this special miracles release had a domino effect. Things began to happen. Amen. Devils were beating people who had no association with Paul. My goodness. Can you believe that? Verse 18. And verse 17. This was known to all the Greeks and Jews also dwelling in Ephesus. Fear fell on all. The name of the Lord Jesus was. First, the Bible says they heard the word. Now, because of this incident of the sons of Sceva being beaten by the devil, who knew who Paul was, now people were magnifying the name of Jesus. Brother and sister, it's going to happen in this land. Durham, Raleigh, Chapel Hill, all over the state of North Carolina, the name of the Lord is no longer going to be in reproach. It's going to be magnified. The favor of God is coming into this land by the power of the Holy Ghost. Amen. The Bible says, verse 18, many that believed came. Hallelujah. So there were some believers who were doing some things in secret. Doing what we call syncretic religion. Serving God and also serving their gods. But this moved them. When the power of God is in manifestation, those who have one leg here and one leg there, they make a decision. There are many people in the church who are double-minded. Amen. There are many people in the church who are Christians, quote unquote, and sleeping around. There are many people in the church full of the Holy Ghost and drinking. Amen. There are many people in the church praying and smoking. There are many people in the church praising God and gossiping. But when the power of God falls, people stop that.
Amen.
When the fear of God hits the church, people become single-minded. May that begin to happen. The Bible says many that believed came, and what did they do? They confessed. Hallelujah. Oh my God. That is going to happen. Shout to somebody, people will confess. People will confess. I keep telling my wife, until that happens, I haven't seen anything. And the people come and say, man of God, I'm sorry. This is what I'm doing. Until that happens, I won't keep quiet. That's the next level. Hallelujah. It must happen. People can say, Pastor, this and that. Hallelujah. We'll not go too deep. Hallelujah. Amen. Oh. In fact, honestly, I have seen people becoming more serious whenever a powerful miracle is done in this church. And you see people becoming more serious, more holy, more sanctified. Hallelujah. When the power of God hit and Ananias and Sapphira went down south, the Bible says the fear of God came on that church. Are you hearing this word? Brother, sir, there's no fear of God in America now. In fact, to be a Christian means you are a lower grade citizen. And people are actually hiding their Bibles. See how they do Bibles now? The way they do Bibles, I don't have any of those Bibles today. No, I don't. They do Bibles and they make it look like a normal book now. You know, they do it with some blue thing and some nice thing and some armor. And it looks like a normal book. That's why I love this Bible. Big. Hallelujah. Hold it. People are scared of identifying themselves as Christians. We have dumbed it down what God used to do. And we walk around and we try to fit in, you know, and not look different. We quieten our hallelujahs. Our amens, we pocket it for Sunday. But now the days are coming where the church, Christians, Jesus is going to come into a strong favor. The name of the Lord is about to be magnified. It will take miracles, signs, and wonders. And if you come and tell me to take my Bible off my desk, maybe by the time you get to your desk, we'll have to carry you to the hospital. And I'll have to come with my Bible and come and raise you from that place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The things are coming where people will be very careful of people who are believers. Where people, the Bible says that certain men will run and catch one man and say, let us be with you. Amen. What am I talking about? Who want to be with us? Hallelujah. Now, people like Christians are, you know, this, they are not very wise, they are not this. But that is changing. That is changing. There's a time where Israel, they were slaves. But there came a day where people were holding them in high esteem in Egypt. To the point where they gave them gold and silver. When somebody gives you gold and silver, that means the evaluation of you has increased. These same people who were their slaves, they are now being valued. The miracle signs and wonders added some value to the status of the Israelites. When there are no miracle signs and wonders, there's no distinction. And the church becomes blah. Amen. We need the miracle signs and wonders to distinguish us. And then the name of the Lord shall be what? Magnified. And what happened after that? They showed their deeds. Hallelujah. Oh, I'm looking forward to those days. When the power of God will fall upon people. And say, my wife, I slept with two women. I'm so sorry. Hallelujah. And the wife, the power of God will fall on them and say, I forgive you. Because it will take power to forgive, won't it? Hallelujah. So you need the power to confess, power to what? Forgive. It will hit. Say it will hit. It will hit. Hallelujah. Oh God, won't go too deep. Verse 19. Many of them also which use curious art brought their books together and burned them before all. When the power of God hits, you won't hide. You will come out. And the Bible says they counted the price of them. And then, okay, but verse 20. Can we all read verse 20? So mightily grew the word of God and Kratos. The word Kratos is prevail. Now the word of God has what? Prevail. May the word of God prevail. May the word of God prevail. What does it mean to prevail? It means to overcome. That means the power of God grew so much that it overcame the demonic kingdom and planted in place the mountain of God, the kingdom of God. Are you hearing this word? God wants to plant the mountain of God in your life. God wants to release the kingdom of God in your life. For that to happen, it will take the power of God. 1 Corinthians 4, verse 19. Are we there? But I will come to you shortly, if the Lord will, and will know not. Are you seeing this? I will know what? Not the speech of them which are puffed up, but Paul is saying that you guys are making a lot of noise. I'm going to come and inspect the church. I'm going to find out those who are just talking versus those who are doing. And that is the context in which he released verse 20. Look at verse 20. For the kingdom of God is not in word, but it is what? It's in power. So the kingdom is in power. This is after Jesus rose from the dead. And our Lord Jesus is still expecting the kingdom to come in power. It's not just words, but what? Power. That is why I believe in miracles. That is why we pray for the sick. That is why we cast out devils. God expects us to do that. Amen. Hallelujah. Can we go to 1 Thessalonians 1, verse 5? For our gospel came not unto you in word. Oh, but also in power. You see that? That's dunamis. Paul says, we didn't just come preaching the word, we also demonstrated the power of God. May our ministry not just be a word ministry, but also manifest in what? Power. May the power of God authenticate the words that God gives us. Amen. Say, Father, energize my words with your power. Amen. Word and power. Amen. We need the word and we need the power. We are winding down. Let's go to 2 Thessalonians 1. 2 Thessalonians 1, verse 11. Look at how Paul prayed for the church. Wherefore also we pray always for you. May this be our prayer, that our God will count you worthy of this calling and fulfill all the good pleasure of his goodness and work of faith with what? Power. To fulfill means to complete. That means without the manifestation of power, you are lacking a key ingredient of your testimony. Amen. He said that, I'm praying that God will count you worthy of this calling. I'm praying that God will fulfill everything he has planned for you. And every work of faith, see, work of faith. How many like the faith movement? One of my fathers in the Lord is Kenneth Hagin. Amen. I started following him when I was just a teenager. And I love the power of God. And I love faith. Amen. And this man preached on faith for almost half of his ministry. And then God said, now begin to talk about the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. So they begin to couple the Holy Ghost and faith. But in the church, the many are hanging on just faith. And are missing the component of the Holy Ghost and power. When the Holy Ghost comes in, what you are believing God for is empowered and comes into place. That means you can have faith for something. But without the power of God in manifestation, what you are believing God for can't be fulfilled. Are you getting it? So yes, we are believing God. God, we are believing you to do this. But without the display of the power of God, that thing won't come. It takes power to complete your work of faith. Say, it takes the power of God to complete and to fulfill my work of faith. Didn't James say that, show me your faith and I'll show you my works? Right? It says, I'll show you my faith by my works. It says that faith without works is dead. So it takes faith plus works for completion. And Paul throws in a curveball. He said, you need the power of God too. Hallelujah. Thank God for faith. Thank God for faith works. But we need the power of God. What does it mean? As you believe God for something and as you stand in faith, the power of God is released.
Hallelujah.
The power of God is released. The woman said, if I may but touch the hem of his garment, I'll be healed. So that was her faith. But she added works to what she believed. So she started moving out, working her way through the crowd until she got to Jesus. And when she touched the hem of Jesus, the faith she had plus the works brought her to a whole different level. And the Bible says that she felt in herself that she was healed. And Jesus said, power of virtue is gone out of me. So the faith plus the works has released what? Power. You see this? So you have faith, you have works, now you need power. Some people, if you touch them, no power comes out. But that will not be our portion.
Amen.
Amen. God wants us to be able to pray this prayer. That Father, every work of faith that I enact in my life, let it be fulfilled with your power. Everything I'm believing you for, release your power to complete it, Lord. Let your dynamic power be released to fulfill what I'm believing you for. Let's say you want to buy, let's say, a Lamborghini. You know me and Lamborghinis. You want to buy a Lamborghini. So you say, how can I demonstrate my faith? So you go to the Lamborghini dealership and you go and look at the Lamborghinis. You check them out. Hallelujah. And I say, well, you must walk to be the Lamborghini. You can't just walk normal. You must walk like somebody who's about to get inside. No, Lamborghini, you have to do yourself like this to get you, you know? So you buy, you go and then you get some of the brooches. Amen. You get maybe the orange Lamborghini. And then you put it on the wall. Every morning, Lamborghini stares you in the face. That's your work of faith. Amen. But that's that you need the power of God to get that card to you. Amen. Amen. So one thing you say, Father, release your power to draw this card to me. Release your power for this body to be healed. Release your power for this bill to be paid. Release your power for this thing to be done. Release your power for my son to be healed. Release your power. You are doing a work of faith. What else do you need? Power. God has given you or expressed his counsel concerning your life. His good pleasure is his counsel. How would that counsel be fulfilled? The power. Are you getting this? So without the power of God, we are missing a key ingredient of our experience. That is where the spirit of mind comes in. Say, spirit of mind, fall upon me. To fulfill every prophetic word, every vision, every word of wisdom that I have ever received. Oh, spirit of mind, fall upon me. To empower every work of faith that I accomplish in my life. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. I believe that God has done it. I believe that God has done it. I believe that the power of God is available for us. I believe that his power is here in this house. I believe he's here to do these things in our lives. We are going to end this completely. This is my very final verse, I promise you. Oh, my Anna. Hallelujah. This is my very last one. Romans chapter 15. Have I convinced you today? That without the power of God in manifestation, we are missing a key ingredient of our Christian experience. Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Romans 15, verse 18. Romans 15, verse 18. Can we read this verse? For I will not dare to speak of any of those things which Christ has not wrought by me. To make the nations or Gentiles obedient by what? Word and deed. Walk to somebody and say, word and deed.
Word and deed.
Go and give somebody high five and say, word and deed.
Word and deed.
Say, word and power.
Word and power.
Word and action. Not well only.
Well indeed.
Hallelujah. Glory be to God in this house. Well indeed. This is a good time for those that the all night is beginning to add to it. Come alive. Amen. He says that I will even talk about what God hasn't done truly. Some of us are working off on somebody else's job. God is ready to do something through you.
Amen.
That is peculiar and unique to you only.
Amen.
That you can say, I did this. Hallelujah. Not for pride, but for you to realize that God can use you. Amen. God is like, I don't go digging where somebody else has done. I go to a place where nobody has done anything. Amen. So that means that when people are running from a place, Paul runs to that very place they run from. He says, I want to go to a place where everybody is failing. Because I know that the power of God with me will make all the difference. The power is what makes the difference. See, power makes a difference. The Bible says that he made the nations obedient. The nations were rebellious to the kingdom of God, but now they are obedient. How did he do it? How did he go to a place like North Carolina and transform that state into a believing state? How did he do it? Verse 19. How? Through mighty signs and wonders by what? By the dunamis. By the power of God. By the power of God. How are we going to make North Carolina obedient? By the power of God. By miracles. By signs. And by wonders. The Bible says so that true. That from Jerusalem. Run about unto Jericho. I have fully preached the gospel. So now you see why I keep saying we, ours is more like a full gospel church. If people are trying to get a pigeonhole to pigeon us in. People always try to like, what kind of church is that? Is it a charismatic church? Is it a Pentecostal church? I don't know. We are what the Bible says.
Amen.
We try to fulfill what the word of God says. So if all gospel fits, fine. If full gospel means something else by the word of God, then it's not fine. But when I say full gospel, I mean a church that has the word and that also has the deed. A full gospel church is not just full gospel. Wow. No. That means you have the word and you have the power in manifestation. You speak and then you demonstrate. You give a speech about what you want to exhibit and then you demonstrate. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I have fully preached the gospel of Christ. So if I preach with just the word only, I have not fully preached the word of God. But when I preach, and by the power of the Holy Ghost, not by my own strength, not by my own experience, but by the Spirit of might, just as Jesus did, we begin to see the power of God. Amen. I mean, if you are sick in this house, come and let's pray. Come and let's believe God. Amen. Hallelujah. If this is your power, if this is your glory, and if this is your presence, let it. Say, Father, I thank you for the healing power of God. Thank you that you sent your son Jesus to die for my sins. By his stripes, I am healed. Save me, O Lord, and I shall be saved. Heal me, O Lord, and I shall be healed. For thou art my salvation. In the name of Jesus. Amen. Father, I thank you for your children as they stand before you. I release the bread of deliverance. I release the bread of healing to them. I rebuke every work of darkness. I break every curse from all their life in the name of the Lord Jesus. And Father, even as they are standing here, you are restoring their health. You are lengthening their days in the name of Jesus. Every law of sin and death is broken. Every spirit of infirmity is cast out in the name of Jesus. Your kingdom has come upon them. Every pain is gone. Hallelujah. Their bodies are receiving the healing power of God. And Father, thank you that healing is beginning now. Thank you that the healing power of God is moving to every crevice of their body. Thank you that diseased organs are being replaced with brand new body parts. Thank you, Father, that the blind are seeing, that the deaf are hearing. Thank you, Father, that Lord, that pain is gone. Blessed be thy name. Thank you, the heart is healed. Thank you, Father, for the healing power of God. I ask the Lord that you complete every work of faith with power in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Glory be to God. Amen. Mr. Come, what are we dealing with? Chest pain. Are you still having a pain? You still having a pain? Awesome. Hallelujah. Awesome. Now we have something we can work with. I mean, how else can we know that, you know, there's something going on? Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Yes, that the arteries are opening up right now. They are becoming elastic in Jesus' name. Every blockage is easing away in Jesus' name. Thank you that the heart organ is being healed right now. Father, and Father, I ask for a new heart organ for your daughter. I pray, Father, that every supporting tissue and ligament right now be healed. Right now, right now, right now. The healing power of God is flowing through you right now. Pain, I rebuke you in Jesus' name. Pain be gone in the name of Jesus. By his stripes, you are healed. By his stripes, you are healed. By his stripes, you are healed. Every spirit of infirmity, leave. Be loose from the heart organ right now. In the name of Jesus, you are healed. You are healed in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Now, my sister, roll your shoulders, you know. Roll your shoulders like this, you know. Like you just stretch yourself a little bit. Yeah? Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. My sister, can I pray for you? What are we praying for? So you're going through chemo, right? And the liver is where this cancer is attacking. Do you believe that God will heal you? When is he going to heal you? He's going to do it tonight. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I am the Lord that healeth thee. I am the Lord your healer. I sent my word and I healed thy disease. I am the Lord. Cancer, die in the name of Jesus. Every seed of cancer, die right now in Jesus' name. Every spirit of cancer, I arrest you in Jesus' name. Go with every breath right now. Be loosed from the liver. Be loosed from the organs of this body. Be dislodged from this one. Now die in Jesus' name. Every seed of cancer, die in Jesus' name. Every cancerous cell, die in Jesus' name. I speak life. I speak healing to the colon. Yeah, there's heat right here. There's heat right here. God is healing you right now. God is healing you right now. The healing power of God is flowing to your belly right now. God is healing you right now. I speak life to the liver. Every excess growth, melt by the fire of God in Jesus' name. Liver, be healed. Be healed. Colon, be healed. Be healed in Jesus' name. I break every serpent out in Jesus' name. Every serpent, I throw you out in Jesus' name. Every serpent, I pull you out in Jesus' name. Every serpent of infirmity, come out. you are healed by his stripes. By his stripes, you are healed in the name of Jesus. Who is here to be healed? What's going on, my sister? In your left lower, okay. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Father, I pray for your daughter. Pelvic inflammation. I rebuke you in Jesus' name. You will not trouble this one again. Affliction will not arise the second time. Pain, I rebuke you in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I command you to be dislodged. Every arrow of darkness be dislodged by the blood of Jesus. I release the healing power of God through your body. Right now, into your body, right now, to your pelvic area in Jesus' name. I command that pain, go in Jesus' name. Every infirmity be loose from this body. Pain, go right now, be loose. I command every serpent, come out. Every serpent of infirmity, come out in the name of Jesus. Every serpent of infirmity, I'll pull you out in the name of Jesus. Healing power of God. I release your virtue through this body. I release the electric power of God through this body. To every nerve right now. I speak healing to the nerves. I speak healing right now to the nerves. Right now. Be healed in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. How is your chest feeling? It's better. God is healing you. Come. Amen. What I saw you doing was being something like this. Like roll your shoulders. You know, there's power. All right. Just roll your shoulders. Hallelujah. Amen. I ask for this work to be completed in the name of Jesus. I release the power of God to your back right now. I release right now you from every pain. I release you from every pain. I release you from every pain. I command total healing. Devil, leave right now. Leave this body now. Be dislodged. Come out in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Yes. Hallelujah. Father, I continue to pray for your daughter. I speak life to the nervous system. Command the nervous system to be healed by the power of the Holy Ghost. By the power of the Holy Ghost. By the power of the Holy Ghost. I release the dynamic power of God to heal this body from every family right now in the name of the Lord Jesus. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. This one. Okay. Lead it out of this one. Oh, okay, okay. By your eyes, this one. Okay, hallelujah. Blessed be the name. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you in the name of Jesus. We give you praise for the healing power of God. Thank you, Father, that you are going to do a new work in her body. This is your daughter. Father, you complete this work in her body. Father, the Lord, that her eyes will be healed totally. I speak life and I speak healing to your eye organ in Jesus' name. I command your eye now to see properly in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus. Father, I pray for this eye. I command every infirmity in this eye to be pulled out. I pull every web of darkness out of your eyes in Jesus' name. I say, be healed by the power of the Holy Ghost. Right, Father, release your power through this body. Just please. I release your power throughout this body right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Every fountain of darkness I command it to see. Every bleeding, I command it to stop now. In the name of Jesus, I release the power of God through this body. I command the healing power of God to flow through your body. From the crown of your head down to the sole of your feet. The healing power of God is flowing through your womb right now. Right now, right now, right now, right now. In the name of the Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for hearing our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
How is your eye now? Yeah. It's good? It's good? Was it good like this when you were coming here today? God powerful.
Amen.
The healing power of God is in this house. Say thank you, Jesus, for healing me in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. My sister, come. Hallelujah. Now that you haven't said your chest or your heart or what?
Chest pain. Are you having a chest pain now? You have no chest pain? Yes, a little burn. But the pain, you have pain when you are coming in.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Where's the pain now? You don't have the pain.
Isn't this wonderful? I do not have the chest pain now. But she came here with a chest pain. And now she doesn't have the chest pain. We have talk. Now the power of God must be demonstrated. And by the anointing also completes. The anointing begins and it also completes. Father, complete this way. Father, complete this work. Father, complete this work. The anointing that completes. The anointing that performs. Complete this work. Let this one walk out of this house totally, totally healed. Totally, totally healed. Totally healed. Every pain gone. Every burning sensation stopped. In Jesus' mighty name. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Now, how is my sister feeling?
Better.
You feeling better?
Yes, sir.
Are you having any pain?
No.
No pain?
No pain.
You do come in with pain?
Yes.
But you have no pain?
No pain.
Isn't God doing something for you? Praise the name of the Lord God of hosts. That cancer is dead.
Amen.
It will pass out of your body. It's dead. Hallelujah. Yes. He's no longer falling prey to allergies. I speak life. I speak healing to your immune system. In the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Do you feel any difference at all? You feel some difference?
What is the difference you feel?
Just like everything here is like
open up.
Yes. Isn't God powerful? He says everything has come. Open up. I felt that same heat you felt. God does have time to show me what is happening. God has healed you. Say, I am healed. In the name of Jesus, God bless you.